project that you've been using for this section uses a flow layout for your collection view. As we mentioned before, a collection view is layout agnostic, and it's the layout class which handles the layout of the items displayed by the collection view. You can have custom layout classes which subclass UICollectionViewLayout to present data in something other than a grid formation. But did you realize that you can subclass UICollectionViewFlowLayout to modify the functionality of the flow layout itself?
Yes, this is possible. You can keep your existing grid layout for your collection view, but throw in some additional functionality to the layout view class to make it behave differently. For example, you can modify the animation you see when a new item is added to the collection view by simply subclassing FlowLayout. If you dig into the documentation for subclassing UICollectionViewLayout, it mentions that for customizing the appearance of the insertion or deletion of items, you have to implement a specific set of methods. One to customize how items appear, initial layout attributes for appearing item at, and another for when items disappear, final layout attributes for disappearing item at. As in the last section, let's start with adding items. First, we need a new file to hold our layout subclass. Add a new group to the project named Layout. Add a new file to this group using the iOS CocoaTouch class template. Set subclass of to UICollectionViewFlowLayout and set class to FlowLayout and save the file. Now in FlowLayout.swift, start by adding an added item property to keep a reference to any new items being added. You'll pass a value to this property when the Add button is clicked in your app. Now override that method we talked about.
This method is called to get the position of the cell, along with a few other attributes, for a new collection view item that is inserted. So you first try to get the default initial layout attributes for the new item. If you can't get any default attributes, you don't want to proceed any further. Then you check that there is a value set for the added item, meaning that an item was just added to the collection view, and that the index path for the new item matches the index path for the item that was just added. If any of these conditions aren't true, you return null. But if all the conditions are matched, then you have the default attributes for the just added cell and return them.
In that case, we want to modify the attributes to place the cell at the Add button position like this. That'll make the add item animation make it look as if the new item floats down from the add button and slowly grows in size. We also set the alpha value of the cell to 1 so that it is fully visible, scale the cell down to 15% of its original size so that it starts out tiny, and set the z-index to a high value so that the cell will appear above all other views.
Note that the initial layout attributes define the size, position, and other visual attributes of the cell as it starts the animation for the item to be inserted into the collection view. Then, the animation runs as the item is inserted, and by the end of the animation, the cell is at its standard size and position in the collection view. That all sounds pretty cool, but you're probably wondering, how the heck do you use this?
Open main.storyboard, and for the main scene, select the collection view flow layout object in the document outline. Switch to the Identity Inspector and change the class to FlowLayout. Open MainViewController.swift and modify AddItem as follows. First, we got a reference to the Layout class of the collection view, which should be of type FlowLayout, And then we set the added item property of the object with the index path of the newly added item as we said we would. Build and run and add an item to see what happens.
You might have to tap the add button a few times before you see the animation on screen.
The animation looks good, but you know what would make things look even better? If we added a small border to the cells in the collection view.
We originally said that we wanted to remove the border, we said that the images looked better without spaces between them, and that's still true.
To be honest, it's hard to come up with simple scenarios to illustrate, but we want to show you a different way to add a border to your cells. While it's certainly possible to add spacing between cells by adjusting the collection view's minimum spacing value, as we did in Section 1, that value is not an absolute value. If you set a minimum spacing of 10 points, the spacing between the cells can be 10 points, or it could be 100. It depends on the size of the cells and the width of the collection view.
But if you set a specific border for collection view cells via the layout class, that border will conform to the specified value, and that's it. There will be no variation. We can hear you out there saying, "All right, we'll add borders, enough with the talk, show us how it's done."
You got it. Open flowlayout.swift and add the following method. The layout attributes for elements in method is another UI collection view layout method which deals with cell layout. This time, this method returns the layout attributes for all the cells and supplementary views for a specified rectangle. In our implementation, you created an empty UI collection view layout attributes array, first, to hold the values you'll return from this method. Now we want to get all the attributes for all of the cells, and then add a border by insetting the cell's frame.
To accomplish that, we call layout attributes for elements in on the superclass to get the default attributes for the cells in the given rectangle. Then we iterate through the fetched values and check to see if the attributes are for a cell by making sure that represent element kind is nil. If the attributes are for a cell, then we get the frame of the item and inset a little bit so that the final cell will be slightly smaller than the original value. Finally, the updated attributes are appended to the result array, and once the looping through of attributes is complete, the result array is returned from the method. Build and run the app.
Okay, I guess it looks nice this way too.
I'm glad you think so after all that work.